In previous videos, I've already talked about most of the pathways represented on this diagram. But I need to come back to acetyl-CoA to discuss lipid metabolism as it relates to energy usage. I'll discuss four main topics here: release of fatty acids from triacylglycerols, beta oxidation of fatty acids to acetyl-CoA, the role of ketone bodies, and finally fatty acid synthesis from acetyl-CoA. To start, I'll talk about the breakdown of triacylglycerols to produce fatty acids. The main point of doing this is to release fatty acids from storage so that they can be broken down to acetyl-CoA, which, as we have seen, can be oxidized in the citric acid cycle to ultimately produce ATP. As you might predict, the release of fatty acids from triacylglycerols is promoted by the hormone glucagon. Remember that this hormone indicates low blood glucose concentration, so there's not a lot of carbohydrate around to use for ATP production. Therefore, the body taps into its fatty acid reserves as a source of energy. Conversely, when blood glucose is high, insulin is produced, and this hormone inhibits the breakdown of triacylglycerols. When glucose is high, there's no need to stimulate production of ATP from fatty acids. Recall that triacylglycerols have three fatty acid chains attached to the three-carbon molecule glycerol via ester linkages. Triacylglycerols are stored in adipocytes, or fat cells. When glucagon levels are high in the bloodstream, an enzyme called lipase is activated to remove the fatty acids from the glycerol. Now, as I've mentioned, the carbons of the resulting fatty acids can be added to coenzyme A to produce acetyl-CoA, and I'll describe this process in the next video. The other product of triacylglycerol is glycerol itself, which can be used to make glucose through the process of gluconeogenesis that I described previously. I created this diagram to show the interrelationships between the different tissues involved. Triacylglycerols are stored in adipocytes. When blood glucose level drops, the hormone glucagon stimulates breakdown of triacylglycerols to fatty acids and glycerol. The fatty acids are released into the bloodstream, where they can be taken up by liver, muscle, and other tissues. Those tissues convert the fatty acids to acetyl-CoA, which can feed into the citric acid cycle to produce ATP. And this is actually the way the liver obtains most of its ATP when blood glucose is low. However, it is noteworthy that fatty acids do not cross the blood-brain barrier, and so the brain cannot obtain energy by acquiring fatty acids from the bloodstream. Now, glycerol produced in the breakdown of triacylglycerols is also released into the bloodstream. The liver takes it up and converts it to glucose through gluconeogenesis. The liver does not use the glucose for itself, but exports it to try to maintain blood glucose at an adequate level. This is particularly helpful for the brain, since glucose is the brain's preferred source of fuel. In the next video, I'll describe the process of beta oxidation, which is how the carbons of fatty acids are added to coenzyme A to produce acetyl coenzyme A.